of changes, a lot of years have gone by since I played this game, but the basics still remain. And I'd like to thank son Marty, Mark, Murray, and our good friend Ed Jackman for sharing with me and with you over 100 years of experience. I love the game. I have always loved the game, and that's why, with special love, we bring this to you. Because to share something that we've enjoyed and I've enjoyed for so many years is a special thing for me. Love, yes. Feelings, yes. Pride, of course. But the main subject here, I like the game and I always will. Hello, our subject today is stick selection and how important it is. I was very lucky, somebody handed me a I-7 and that's lived with me throughout my whole career. But what we have in a stick selection is the lie, and in particular today you have more choices. You have the plastic, you have the wood, and then you have the metal stick. In the days when first started out, it was the wood. And what it consists of at that time, there's a lot of ash and the trees nowadays, and the tree line in which they pick this stick is a very solid one. So when you picked up a stick, you had a very good piece of lumber in which to perform with. But from that point on, they went to lamination and everything else. But what is more important is the height of the stick, what do you prefer to it. You also have what we call a lie. And when we talk about the lie of the stick, it might come as a surprise a lot of people, but the preference of it, a low lie, and that depends on the angle in which the shaft comes off the blade. And so a high lie, I'm up in here in the 7, as if you get a lower number, 6, 5, 4, you go down, and I know Marty used a lower lie, I use a 7, and I don't know what Mark's preference is, but I do know that the wood stick, when you went from city to city, what would happen in the belly of the plane, they'd pick up moisture, and what you had when you left town is not the same stick you had when you got to the other city, because when you lean on them, instead of having that little flex that comes back that adds to your wrist shot, all of a sudden it wasn't there, you'd bend on it and it'd stay bent. And no, this is not the length of a stick, but what it is the insert, which is a new model which Mark uses.
Yeah, it's, and also another thing too, Dad, I think all you guys can see, it's the curve that I have here on the blade is only you're allowed from this point to the heel of your stick, the biggest point of curve, you're allowed a half an inch. And so my sticks are made right at a half an inch or just under. So we have a coach on our hockey team that likes to call penalties on other teams for illegal curves. This type of blade right here goes into, which I use, an aluminum shaft stick. And all you have to do is you heat the end of the aluminum down here, you just insert the shaft, and I like it. I get a consistent feel, and you can see here I have the finished product, and it's great. When you come to the rink, I have the same feel every day, because there was a number of times where I'd be coming to the game with old wooden sticks, and for some reason wooden sticks were breaking on me a lot. So for me, this is my choice. For other people, they like wood sticks a lot better. Marty, what do you like?
Well, no matter what kind of stick you use, you have to use a tape, and I'm just going to demonstrate different tapes. Tape jobs. We got one like Bobby Orr used to use. He used to give it one or two wraps at the heel, and that would be it. And I think the only reason he did it is because somebody told him he had to. Whereas myself, I like to tape all the way to the end.
Doing a pretty good job there, Marty.
Yeah.
The boys, you recognize
that? A couple years of practice. And what happens is I feel with the puck, it doesn't slide off my stick as much when I have more tape on the blade, and that's why I enjoy that. Also on handles, this happens to be Gordy's handle, and he has a preference for a rougher type handle. Whereas on mine, here I have a longer, smoother type handle, where I like to move my hand from the top to the bottom and switch a lot. And that's how we got into the sticks.
And when we talk about hands, I just want to say the most important hand on the on a stick is what we call the upper hand. And I am a hand man. When I watch young players play, I like to see a freedom of hands. And in order to give you that freedom, the position of the top hand is very important. The lower one acts as more or less as a sleeve. It's up and down. And the only time you get a firm grip is actually when you make contact with the puck. But the hand position, and if you, I can illustrate the top of the shaft, it comes straight up. And if you look like the little V between the first finger and the thumb, what we have is almost a direct V right straight up the arm to the shoulder. The reason we do that, and we'll get into that further, but in that position, you're so much stronger and give you the freedom to go wherever you want with it. On this hand, you are limited a great deal. So I would suggest, and really, I insist, that you youngsters put your hand in that position because it's a success story in itself. Somebody taught me, it helped me a great deal, and what we're trying to do is relay this message on to all you and you young men who can put this into a practice.
Oh, I think looks like I might have learned something there, too. I hope you guys learned a little something. And I want to go out and apply that and see if that works out on the ice. What do you think? Let's go.
Let's give it a hand.
Let me relate once again about the hand position. I do believe that it's a key. I know it's a key to good stick handling. When I mentioned you grab the stick with almost the fingers of your hand. So that lays it straight on up the shaft. The V between the first finger and the thumb goes right up the arm. I want your hands extended. I do not want them up here in a position where if the puck goes to my left, I cannot get at it. I want the hands down and don't handle the puck too much. The youngsters have an indication that this is more comfortable. But what it does, it prevents you from, once again, going over to the side. And if you watch, take special note with Marty Mark, the top hand, how much it does. You push a puck when you're going through this position. You do not handle it in this way. If you do, you stand a good chance to lose it. If nobody's checking you, you push it in this way, and you can see where the upper hand is, way over here. Now, when I turn the blade over to push the other way, my hand goes all the way over the other side. So what we're trying to do, and we're going to do before this is all over, we're going to have your hand in proper position, which is the key to a good stick handler.
All righty. Keep your head up. Good job. And last peek at the end.
Okay, let's concentrate on the young man's top hand. And what you notice, he starts off well. He should have his hands a little lower, but when he gets a little quicker, he'll have problems. Right now, he's freezing it to his body, which does not give him a freedom. So I would suggest that anybody watching, drop that hand.
There you go. All right, Brent, doing a good job. Keep your head up. Good job. All right, let's see you go back with a little bit more speed here. Keep the puck out in front of you. You're doing a great job.
It's obvious this young man is a little more advanced. You can see the freedom of the hand. He even takes the lower hand off to give him that freedom, push it over. That's a good exercise. He's obviously a little more advanced and much stronger. He does a very fine job.
Go ahead, David. There you go. Keep your head up now. So you get the puck out in front of you. There you go. Good job. Good job. There we go. Get the puck out in front of you. All right, good job, David.
Now we watch young David with his expertise. As you notice, the top hand, once again, is a problem. He hasn't learned to go across his body, so puck is kept in a pushing position. On his way back, he was forced into one position there when he passed the pylon. He did pass it over. That's good. That's a good sign that he is learning.
Okay, all the way back.
Now with this advanced player, you notice he can handle a puck well, but he's handling it too much. If he has speed and somebody to worry about in front of him, he's going to have trouble. He's going to lose that puck. I would suggest, and we're going to tell him, that he should push it more so he can look up ahead and see what's in his way. Now Marty will demonstrate in a standing position how to properly pass a puck. As you notice, whenever you're passing the puck, there is a target in mind. It is not the youngster himself, it's the stick, which might be 2 or 3 feet from him. So whatever you do in the game of hockey, you have to have a target. But the most important thing, and we go to that upper hand again, as you notice, both hands will go directly at the target, and at the point of release, the upper hand comes into the body, and the lower unit will pronate and point at the target. And in doing so, a properly executed is fine. In receiving the pass, you'll notice that the blade will have to be square with the puck coming in. If it is towed in, the puck will squeeze into your feet. And Marty will demonstrate a couple of no's. In that case, you have to look down and you can get hurt because there are checkers in this game. If it's towed out, it'll run away from you. And when Marty shows this, but really the true reason why a puck receiver is very important on a passing is simply if he presents his target square with the puck, you will cradle it very nicely in the blade of the stick and be on your way. All right, now you see Marty in slow-mo, and what he is actually demonstrating, and he's overdoing it, but you have to have a semi-cushion when the puck comes in. As a youngster, I would prefer you not to point at the puck when it's coming your way. This is through 13 years of professional hockey that he has acquired that skills. As a youngster, I would suggest you just keep it square with the play when it comes in this position, and in doing so, the puck will be controlled very easily. Now we go into the hand position where Marty, see how far out in front of those hands are? That's the freedom of movement I want. I want those hands free from the body, extended, both hands going at the target. In doing so, the upper hand will come into the body and the lower hand will pronate and point right at the target in that manner. All right, now once again, we have an additional pass, one which we call a flip pass, but what is more important is the basic execution of this pass. What we have to have is from the toe to the heel. As you notice Mark, when he's passing that, the puck will be cradled in the heel of a stick, and then he runs across in a flat position. Actually, the toe releases the puck, and by doing this, what he is doing, he's raising the puck maybe a foot or so off the ice and it's lying flat, so the intended receiver will not have to fight the puck at the other end. Now the youngster, if you notice, when he's thrown over, because of Mark's experience, he can cradle a puck, but the puck is coming to him rolling and flipping and it's very, very difficult to control. And what often looks like a good pass from the way up in the stands to the observer actually is a very badly executed pass, because what it is doing a flip-flop position, and while you're looking and trying to get hold of that pass, somebody's taking a run at you. Please notice what we've been talking about, how the upper hand holds that stick. It's in a proper position. He's semi-low in the hand, and as you notice with the B, it extends, and that gives him the opportunity to do what he wants. But there was a perfect example now of how the lower hand acts as a sleeve. You notice how the hand slid very far up the shaft so he could reach out farther. That is a proper demonstration on the follow-through. Now the height of the shot or the pass is determined by the follow-through, and as you notice, Mark wants it maybe over six inches off the ice, so when releasing it on the way up, that's exactly where he releases it. Now I'd like to introduce what we call the drop pass. With Travis, I will pick up the puck, circle over the far side, pretending that the defensemen have backed up, give me that blue line, I'll cross the blue line, and with them backing up, I will execute the drop pass. And by doing so, I should properly stop it in a given position. I will not put a tail on it, because if I put on tail and it squirts either right or left, it'll confuse my fellow teammate. The secret to a drop pass is just basically stop it and leave it in a position like you set it up on a tee so he can come in and shoot it, slap it, pass it, whatever he wants to do. But the secret to it is to do not, I repeat, do not put a tail on it. Dead center, attaboy. And now Marty, Mark, and myself would like to demonstrate the back pass. Unlike the drop pass, it is propelled to your fellow teammate. So I will drop myself in center. The boys will show you the proper execution of this pass. Okay. All right, let's make her good, Marty. Right on the blade. Attaboy. Mark. That was going good, going good. Target, good boy, Mark. All righty, Marty, right on target, good. I think the hardest thing in the world to do is to pass a puck properly while going backwards, especially if it's a drop pass. It's extremely hard. And Marty demonstrates that even an errant pass can be handled properly. If it's a little hard to get at with the blade, what you do is kick it up with your feet. I'll throw it into Mark's feet here and let him show you. And that's an exercise that should be practiced a lot. But when we're back passing, don't mind me, I'll go left-handed every now and then. But what you should do is learn how to cradle a pass and also cradle it on the turn. When you're going around the turn, you'll notice how Mark will cradle it in that manner, and it really, what it does, it gives you complete control. That's a good one. But also, it's very important, as we showed you earlier, you've got to give a passer a target. You have to have the stick on the ice, and that's why he's an all-star.
As a receiver of the pass, I have to get myself in position for my teammate. Daddy here drops the pass for me. I can either shoot or pass. I like to pass, put it out in front of Dad, and he just tips it home.
Okay, let's just talk about the stick for a second. I use a stick that's fairly long, so I have a low lie. People that want to have a shorter stick have a high lie. Now, if you notice a kid that is skating around the ice with their stick and their elbow up like this, that means their stick is probably too long. So you might want to cut it off to a distance that's just below their chin. Also on curves and receiving passes, I use a bit of a curve that has a wedge effect, so it kind of narrows out, whereas my brother Mark has a stick that cups at the end here. Now they're going to demonstrate a few passes here behind me, and we'll talk about it.
Okay, what we're showing here, when the puck comes in from different angles, I have stationed the boys in such a position that puts me as a receiver, I have to have my stick square of the play. So the upper hand, once again, becomes very important, because to receive a puck from that angle, my hand has to be in that position. From over on the far left, I have to be out in front of me in this position. It's up to me to set the target. So when I throw it over in this angle, when it comes to me, I give the target over here, perfect. Dead center is good. Now when we're going the other side, we go over, but I have to get out in front. Whoop, the stick. Let's try that again. Hit the stick. Attaboy, that's good. The target is there. Both hands has been demonstrated. I stop lower hands in that position and drive it straight at the blade of the stick. Attaboy, that's good.
Okay, we're gonna do a little bit of puck control and stick handling. Now when you guys get the puck, if you wanna be able to see where you're going, you have to be able to look up and push the puck in front of you. So to do that, instead of going back and forth and chopping all over, I want you just to carry it out in front and push the puck back and forth like that, and you don't have to look down. So we're gonna try that now. We'll give you each of a puck. We're gonna skate to the blue line here, keep our heads up, hands out in front of us, and push the puck like that. Okay, let's try it. Good job. That's it, let's go to the other blue line. Now keep your upper hand on top of the stick like that, that's right. That's good, guys. Now remember, keep that puck out in front of you. If you get the puck and you're skating down the ice and you lose the puck, if you have it on the side, you have to come back and get it. But if you have it out in front of you, if you lose it, you can always drop your stick back to get the puck. Let's try it one more time. Keep our heads up, watch where we're going. That looks good, guys.
Now, here Marty demonstrates the art of stick handling, and once again we stress the upper hand. It's all over the body in the way of controlling it because he's trying to keep the blade square with the puck, and this way, giving the opportunity to look down ice, see what play to make. As you see, as he crosses the blue line, he puts the puck over in a shooting position, which he can either pass or shoot. In this case, he elects to shoot. Now Marty demonstrates in a little quicker speed, and you notice the hands react a little quicker, but the basics are the same. They're pushing the puck, the head is up to see where he's going, and he's in total control.
Often there's times in a game when you're trying to kill time. If you can effectively rag the puck, say killing a penalty or whatever, you can kill valuable time in a game and help your team a lot. What you try to do is keep the puck out in front of your body and keep it away from the opponent trying to check you. If you can, definitely keep your body between yourself and between the puck and the opponent. If you can do that, 90% of the time you're going to keep the puck away from it. We'll demonstrate here with Christian how to do this. Here, get him behind me here. Okay, there you go. Try and get the puck away. I keep the puck out in front of me as he tries to come around. I keep myself between Christian and the puck. Okay, here, I'll let Christian try. Christian, you give it a try. All right? Now, see, I'll come around this side here. See, notice Christian turns and keeps himself. There you go. And he's keeping himself between me and the puck. Now, if I can get in there and get my stick, notice how Christian's keeping his balance. He has his knees bent. If he straightens his knees up, I can pull him down. He has pretty good balance. He's doing a very good job. All right, good job, Christian. That's the easy way to kill time. Good job, Christian.
You know, gang, there are several ways to stay in shape, and there's many reasons why you should do certain exercises. A young lady who's in her midst has to do her particular exercise. To the younger fellas, hey, at your age, you're always in shape. But when you get a little older, there's a weight problem, and there's also the toning of the muscles. Now, in my days, and I hate to bring back the past, but actually, what we have today is the modern equipment. Marty had his method, Mark has his method. In our days, the sincerity I had towards the game were such that I said, the secret to it is staying in shape 12 months of the year. And what you have to do, in my case, when I went back to my hometown in Saskatchewan, what I would do is take a construction job. That meant I would handle concrete, handle gravel, do what I ever had to do to maintain my weight. And I still think the secret to longevity, as far as I'm concerned, is my training to stay in shape for 12 months a year. And also, a key was to keep complete control of my weight, because after 34 years of the whole section of my career in hockey, I think the only difference of change from weight, I joined at the age of 16, I was 204 pounds, and when I retired at the age of 52, I was 206 pounds. So I think that was a great secret, and Marty had his secrets.
Well, I started out mostly riding my bicycle, because hockey has a great deal to do with your legs. If you don't have the speed and the strength, you won't be as good a player. So riding the bicycle, I find, strengthens your legs, and it's a very good exercise for hockey. I also do a little bit of swimming. I think that works overall on a little bit of conditioning, and it works all the other bodies, you know, in your arm or muscles in your body, your arms, your legs, and all the other limbs. So I think Mark might have a few exercises or tips also.
Also, I've done a little swimming myself, and that was, the game now is a lot more scientific than what it was 13 years ago when I started playing. when I first started playing, most of the guys didn't do anything in the summer, and your conditioning level was mostly playing tennis or going out and just walking around the golf course as fast as you could. But the game's changed a lot now, and they've proven that over the course of the season, your hockey season, your conditioning level drops down a little bit. So what people do in the summertime is you try to raise the level of your conditioning, and you do that through, that's when I did my swimming, I had to rehabilitate, which was I had a bad injury to my shoulder, and I had to mend it. So a lot of the training I did, I would swim a mile, and that's known as an aerobic training. It's a constant effort on your part, get your heart working for a good, I used to do about 45 to 50 minutes. Or else I can do a lot of sprint training, which is your aerobic, anaerobic training. So what I can do, you can either run, you can do sprints at intervals. You'll run for 30 seconds, rest for 30 seconds. You'll do, say, 30 minutes of that. Or else you can do a lot of training on a bicycle. You can play a real hard tennis on your days off. Or there's an awful lot of exercise. And then also there's weight training. You have to, the muscles that you have, I don't recommend it for real young individuals, but I think as you get older, if you want to get stronger, you work on your weaknesses in the game. If you have real strong legs, you maintain the strength in your legs, but then you build your upper body. If you have a real strong upper body and not the legs to carry it, then you have to work on your legs.
Well, you remember what we used to do in the driveway also during the summer is the ball hockey. It works for your shots. You know, you do a lot of running, and you get to use your sticks. You know, use a tennis ball or a rubber ball. I used to get a lot of bloody noses. I was playing goal, and Mark was doing all the shooting.
No matter what kind of conditioning you do off the ice, still the best thing you can do for hockey is do your conditioning on the ice. But it's when the ice is not available, that's when you do your conditioning off the ice.
But there's another how is going to show up in these exercises, and that's going to be the younger son, Murray, who is a doctor and has played a lot of hockey.
All right. How many of you guys like to play hockey?
Me!
All right. Well, have a seat. You know, we've been talking about keeping in shape during the regular season, and now we're going to talk about how to keep in shape during the off season, because it's important to keep in shape all year round so that you don't get hurt and that you're able to keep going, right?
Right.
All right. So let's run through some stretches that are real good for hockey players, okay, for working their upper body and their lower body, getting it all limbered up, okay? So let's have you spread out a little bit and just give yourself some room so you don't kick each other in the head, and just kind of follow me, okay? Okay, over here we have Greg. He's working on this unit, which is working the muscles of his chest, his pectoralis majors. He's also working on his shoulders here. Greg's doing a really good job here. He's really working. He's blowing out each time that he's pushing the weight in, and I think he's getting a good workout here. It's important to know with someone around Greg's age that you should be at least 14 years old before you attempt any kind of heavy weightlifting like this at all. Now here we have Jason working on a machine. It's working the shoulder girdle muscles here, the deltoid muscles. These are very important muscles in hockey for your shot, and it's a very difficult exercise to do. Jason's doing a real good job with it here.
One thing. A lot of these exercises you should and you must consult with your physician, because some exercises are not necessarily good for certain people. So I would suggest that if you're very serious and you want to improve yourself in a way of physical strength, you should consult your physician. It'll help an awful lot.
Let's just review a few of the things we learned today. First of all, in your hand position, you have your hands out in front of you. Your stick should go straight.
Somebody comes to check you, you're going to be knocked over. Also, when carrying the puck, if somebody's coming to check you, you keep the puck in front and your body in between the puck and the person trying to check you. Also, we're going to review a little bit about the passing. Okay, anytime you pass, hands must be out in front of your body, away from your body. Hands go through and follow through at the target for a nice pass. If you can, pass the puck on the ice. If not, flick the puck a little bit, get it in the air, make sure it comes down soft, and always aim at the target.
Now, a recap on receiving the pass. What we talk about is keeping square with the puck, and as you notice, the puck coming from this angle, I will hold my stick in this position. Now, if it's coming in from over here, I have to use that upper hand once again to throw it out to get me square with the puck. By doing so, you will receive the puck with no problem whatsoever. By opening the stick up, if it's coming in from this angle and I go like this, it'll hit and run off automatically. If I overdo it and do it in this manner, it'll be into my feet, therefore causing me a lot of problems. Now, in the carrying the puck, what we do, instead of stick handing back and forth, we push it in this manner. And what I can do, I can walk around the ice and do what I want, look, talk to people, go one hand, whatever it is, as long as I'm just pushing the puck. And the secret to that, once again, is once you're in this position on this side, you notice the upper hand, it has to go almost across my body to get at it. See, in this position to push it. Now, a backhand, going to the right and left is all the same thing. Now, the secret to that and handling the puck in this manner is that when you're ragging the puck, killing time on a penalty for your team, what you do is keep you between the opposition and the puck. And when you feel, when you're in the corner, say, and you feel the pressure of a player on this side of you, then go this way, because obviously you know where he is. If he's on this side pushing, you go that way. And that is the secret to the success of killing puck. Now, what makes a good strong player? Exercise. And is it 1 month of the year? No, it's 12 months of the year. The secret is that you, number one, sometimes can push yourself away from the table, stay away from some of the sweet food to put on weight. The maintenance of an even weight is very important, but also the exercise is very, very important. Exercise the leg as well as the upper portion of the body. And if you're going to get technical about it, I suggest that you consult your physician, because some exercises are not necessarily good for all people. Now, would we like to touch briefly on passing as well as shooting, because it's actually the same execution. What you do is pick your target. You walk into your target, square the stick off, hands out in front of you, low, shoot, and you're right on target if properly executed. So remember, if you want to be a good shooter, you definitely have to be a very good passer. We're going to feed this one a little more, guys.
That's right.
Well, thanks for joining us. Yes, and remember one thing. Practice doesn't make perfect. Perfect practice makes perfect.
Thank you again. We'll see you soon.
Let's go.
Come on.
There you went.